When your image opens up in Photoshop, you want to duplicate your layer. So just on a PC it would be Control J, on a Macintosh it would be Command J, and it'll create a new layer above your original background, and we'll just call this painting before we do anything to it. Now in CS5 we have these new mixer brushes that really do a bang up job of creating painterly like simulations, and they're located under the regular brush tool. If you click and hold on that, you'll see the submenu, and you want to come down to where it says mixer brush tool, and that's the brush tool icon with a little drop of paint above it, just so that you're aware. You're also going to see a new mixer brush preview over here, and by default I have already selected a particular brush. I'm going to actually open up the mixer brush presets here so you can see them. The fan high bristle count is what I currently have selected. You can see its little graphical icon looks quite different from the other brush diameter previews that you're used to seeing. All of these are the mixer brushes, the new special brushes. They have different graphical icons in here and different behaviors. You can create a mixer brush out of any brush though, if you select it, and just apply these attributes to it. So these other tip sizes can become it, but I have found that these really work well. So I am going to do the flat fan high bristle count and just collapse this out here. The other thing too, if you want to make this little preview bigger, you can. It has different behaviors if you use a mouse versus a Wacom pen. Right now I have the mouse, and as I move this you see the icon. I'm not pressing or anything, but the graphical representation of the brush tip is just staying vertical in the picture and in this preview here. Now if I use my Wacom pen and tilt or move my brush, you can see it has a totally different appearance than when using a mouse. And if I start to paint with it, you'll see that little preview window over here changes on the fly as I'm doing this. Okay. Now you can use a mouse, you don't have to go out and get a Wacom, although I do recommend them highly. What you want to do with the painting here is to just click and jiggle a little bit. So you want to go around some of these areas. And the particular size that I have on this image is, it says 59 here. When I get into the shirt, if I want more paint applied, I'll make it bigger. I'm going to jump back to my Wacom pen so you can see this and zoom in on the image a bit so we can see it a little bit more. And I will just click and jiggle, click and jiggle. Now in the shirt area I can make my brush tip bigger too, so just so I can get this done. It's kind of vibrating here, but I'm just jiggling around just to give that a liquidy, sloppy appearance. Use my space bar to pan around. The idea to muck this up is to make sure, you don't have to listen to what I say, but it's sort of a painter principle, that you don't want on your muck up layer or your painting layer, you don't want to sort of leave it showing through regular pixels that are there. We just want to muck everything up on this particular layer. So if you see a little area in here, just tap it and jiggle. Okay. And you can vary your size of your brush and, you know, tilting it if you've got that Wacom pen, which is very nice to do. So we're just basically mucking it up. And I'm doing the exterior right now. Let me talk about some options that I have set up there in the top options bar. You can see I've chosen a moist heavy mix. There are other options in here that you can choose. There are presets for the behavior of the paper and the brush, and these other settings, wet, load, and mix, and flow. The one that you probably want to be most aware of is the mix setting here. If I jump my brush out here to the white space, say I want to put some paint down, notice that even though my preview is showing a color here. It's not putting it down here. In fact, this is showing a solid color, but you can load your brush to choose with solid colors only. But if you come out here and alter option click on an area of pattern, it actually puts it up there. And I can go out here into this white area, and if I paint, nothing's going on, and that's because my mix is set to 100%. So if I want to put some of that paint out there, I can do it one of two ways. I can start with an area of color and then just brush it out to make it flow in, or I can lower my mix amount here, lower that down. And now when I go in a white area with the brush, I still have what's called a dirty brush. I'll go over that as we go. I can add a little bit of that color or sampling to this area. When I go back up to 100%, if I want to just mix what I see on here now, I start in the area of the white. If I want to push the white in to cover up some of that blue, if I want to spread that paint around, start there and push it out. So it works very much how paint works when it is on paper or canvas. And then I can smear this around as well, just kind of mixing it in. And these settings up here, this one right here, if I click that, it's going to clean my brush. See how the preview is checkerboards? So if I don't want it to, I have a clean brush now. And when I go to mix this or other things, it doesn't have that other paint on it. But if I turn that back on through here, or, you know, load brush here, two little settings that you can use in these icons, you know, now it's going to have some of that color on it. But again, if I'm going into a white area and my mix amount is 100%, all I'm doing is mixing what I'm seeing beneath that brush. Turn down that mix a bit, and it's going to apply a bit of we've got in that preview window. If I wanted to choose a solid color, you know, the easiest way to do that, I could click right here, load solid colors only. And now when I click on, say, a black area here, and if I have my mix down and my brush out in a white area, it's putting down that black. If I want to go back to the colors that are in the image already, I'll uncheck that so that when I alter option click here, it's going to allow me to pick up on these. And now I want to mix it without putting any more paint down from the source point. I just want to mix that white and the skin color and the blue, just muck it up in here. Just for a little bit of stuff. I'm going to make my brush bigger, hitting my right bracket key, and just continue like a press and jiggle. Because you just want to get that painting vibe going on the face. Just a little jiggle. Okay. Another thing I want to mention is how to get rid of that brush preview of the live brush. If you want to, you just open up the either the brushes panel or the brush presets here. At the bottom of both of these panels is a little eyeball with a brush, and if you click on that, it will turn off that little brush preview. If you want to get it back, just click it back on, do that, and it's back. You can have it at this size, or if you click these double arrows, just have a little tiny preview of it. Okay, so we're just about done here with the initial mock-up. Let me zoom out a bit and, yeah, make sure I've got, and I'm going to Alt-Option-Click in the hat here, lower my mix amount, make my brush a little bit smaller. I'm just going to add some stuff in here. A little sloppy paint. Take my mix back up. Blend this in a bit. Make my brush bigger. Okay. The wet amount too is referring to the paper. If I increase that, I'm going to get a little bit more liquidy effect, on these blends here as well. Just come back in here. So it's a matter of, I'm still getting to know this particular new brush engine in CS5, and I think it's a matter of just jumping in there and playing and experimenting. Make this smaller. Scooch that around. Okay, so that's pretty sloppy right there. You might want to go in here and just do a couple more little swigs. Again, you can switch up on the brushes. Just play with them. And when I'm done with this, what I'm going to do is just lower the opacity on this a bit to about 75 to 80, and we've got kind of a sloppy look, but here's what else we're going to do. We're going to come beneath it, click on that background layer again, and we're going to duplicate it. So Control J on a PC, Command J on a Macintosh, and we're just going to call this the line and paper color layer because we're going to add some stuff to this. So this is the original. If I shut my painting layer on, we've got the original that we brought in from Camera Raw. And I want to accentuate the line a little bit more. So with this highlighted, all we're going to do is add a little bit more sharpening to it. So we're going to go under Filter, Sharpen, and to Unsharp Mask. When this dialog box comes up, just take the amount all the way up to 500. You can play with the radius and threshold a bit, but it's basically going to be between 1 and 2 pixels. And your threshold amount, again, that's sort of like the masking slider that was in the sharpening settings in Camera Raw, in that the interior areas it'll keep kind of smooth, and we want those exterior sort of line areas a little bit sharper. So we'll do that, and then we're going to also add a layer effect to this, and that's why it's important that we duplicated the background layer, because you can't add layer effects to this background layer. So we're going to come down here to the FX icon, and mine is not, it's going below the thing. Anyway, click this in the list that drops down. You want to choose Color Overlay, and that's going to open up the Color Overlay dialog box. First thing we're going to do is change that blending mode to Multiply, and then we're going to click the color swatch, and we want to get kind of a buff color. So we'll come down here in this golden area, kind of tawny between yellow and red. We're going to click up here somewhere to get a nice buff color for paper. Then you can, once you click in that area in the big swatch, you can kind of play around with the hue a little bit. If you want it a little bit rosier, just move your slider down. And that looks good to me. So I'm going to click OK and OK. So we have at this point added a new color substrate or paper to the background of our sloppy glaze look painting. And now we're going to add a little bit of a vignetting on the outside so it looks like it's bleeding in there. I'm going to shut that brush thing off. And how we do that is grab the regular freeform lasso tool. Let me zoom out a bit on the image. And what I want to do is just make an irregular border draw with this lasso tool. Coming in a little bit on the edges. It can be very irregular. You can hold your shift key if you decided you went in a little bit too far there, but just do something like that. And then what you're going to do is inverse that. Just go under the top select menu, select inverse and click on your top painting layer, because the new border edge, we want to come in above our painting, so make sure the top layer is highlighted so it does come in above that. And then come down to the bottom of the layers panel, and we want to choose this black and white circle here and add a solid color fill layer to it. So we're going to come move our pick a color out here. What we want to do is kind of stay within this buff range, but make it lighter. So it's going to target that color that we have for the paper, but then we're just going to bump it up a bit like that and click OK. And then with the, I'm going to make a mistake intentionally, because this is going to happen to you undoubtedly at some point or another when you are dealing with masking or layers that produce masks. I want to blur out this edge so that it feathers in nicely with the artwork. So I'll go under Filter, Blur, Gaussian Blur, and I'm going to get this dialog box. It says must be rasterized, blah blah blah. Okay, cancel out of that. The reason why it's saying that, because in CS5 it's like the default thing when you create something is does not highlight the mask automatically. So what you have to do, It's just looking at this little icon here, which is basically a set of instructions, and you can't apply an effect to a set of instructions. It has to be on a pixel layer or a mask layer, which has, you know, 8 bits. It's still pixels, just black and white and shades of gray in between. So you want to make sure that you highlight the thumbnail of the mask. You'll see a tiny little outline around it. I'm going to click back on the instruction for the color fill over here, and you'll see the outline disappears. So make sure that this is highlighted, the mask, and then go to Filter, Blur, Gaussian Blur, and no problems. So we just want to feather that out so that it gives us a nice little blurring effect like paper. We're still not done. Okay, so the next thing that I'm going to do is make a merged composite of our image thus far. Here's what we started with. Here's where we are now. And I've got the top layer highlighted. And if you hold down Shift, Control, Alt, and the letter E on a PC, that would be Shift, Command, Option, E on a Mac, it will create a composite layer. I have a free action that does this on my page if you want to download it. Layer to Merged Composite, I think, is the name of it in my freebies section. So you'd only have to hit that button to make it do it. So we've got this composite, and to it I want to add a little bit of tooth, a little bit of grain. Now you can, there's several, you can actually go into the texturizer filter, but I'm going to do something a little different just to give it some tooth, and that is to just go Filter, Noise, Add Noise. We're going to have a little bit of monochromatic noise depending on your image. You just want to give it sort of a soft look, and then you want to go back in and blur that noise with the Gaussian blur. Not that much, however, just a minuscule amount, just about like that. And click OK. And then you can lower the opacity of this new texture layer that you've created just so it blends really nicely with what's underneath. So you've got it without the tooth and with the tooth, and it looks a little better there. So the final thing that you want to do on an image like this, I guess, is to create a signature layer. So let's see, let's name this one. This is the tooth layer or texture. So we'll create a blank layer. Click the new layer icon at the bottom of the layers panel and give you a blank layer, and we're going to call this signature. So it's a blank layer we've got highlighted. We're going to come back over to our brush tool, but now we are going to use the regular brush tool, and we want to get an airbrush. And if you're in CS5, they have deprecated the old standard brushes into the flyout menu. So if you click this to select an airbrush, you're just going to find the set that's in there by default. Now, I've already loaded mine, but the old set, if you click the flyout tab, is called Round Brushes with Size. So click that and append it so that you can go to your old airbrushes. I'm going to get an airbrush soft round. Doesn't matter what size. I'm going to take that size down to probably about 3 for this size image. And black is the foreground color. Hit D for the default colors. Black's foreground color. And what I'm going to do is actually do a select all, Control A. I want those marching ants running around my canvas, because a lot of times when I'm doing signatures, I may not like what I did here. And if that selection is around that layer, I can just simply hit delete and start anew. So I'm just going to do my signature here, Mama Shan, and I can do a Control T if I want to scale that, just make it smaller, reposition it like this, double click, and then deselect, Control D or select, deselect, and lower the opacity a bit on my signature layer. And we're done. Hope this helps with your future art and creations. Thanks for watching.